Welcome to the second chapter of this course, in which we discuss location issues. Let's consider the design overview introduced in the previous week. The overview describes all aspects that are essential for an accurate design of a PV system and the related energy yield prediction. In this week, we will focus on issues that are location-specific, including analysis of local meteorological data, a survey of the landscape surrounding the PV system, and the resulting irradiance on the so-called plane of the array. This chapter is divided in five main points. First, we will start with some concepts and terminology related to solar irradiance. Then, we will discuss the fundamentals to calculate the position of the sun in the sky. You will be able to do it for every location on Earth at an arbitrary time and date. With the position of the sun in mind, we can calculate the optimal tilt and orientation angles of mounting of the PV modules. We shall also spend some time on mechanical tracking. After that, you will learn all about the landscape survey. This is instrumental to compute the energy yield in a realistic way that includes the environment too. Finally, we will discuss some advanced irradiance modeling concepts. In this picture, the global horizontal irradiation is shown all over the world. The horizontal irradiance is the amount of energy incident on a flat horizontal surface of 1 square meter. The energy is expressed in kilowatt hour. As we can see, the horizontal irradiation can vary strongly in different locations on Earth. Obviously, the regions with the highest intensity are located in the tropics around the equator. When we move away from the equator, the irradiation drops until approximately 1,000 kilowatt hours per square meter in the very north of the map. The difference is not only in the amount of energy received during the day, but also in how it is distributed during the year. Indeed, the more you move away from the equator, the stronger the difference becomes between summer and winter. This is known as a seasonal variation, and it plays a very important role in the design and the reliability of the PV system, in particular for the storage. So, if you want to produce the same amount of energy for two PV systems, one in the Netherlands, where the irradiation is almost 1100 kilowatt hours per square meter per year, and one in Abu Dhabi, where we have almost 2200 kilowatt hours per square meter per year, then the number of PV modules in the Netherlands should be almost the double of the PV modules in Abu Dhabi. Thus, it is very important to look into the environment in which the PV system will be installed. In this video, we will start with the solar irradiance. We will discuss some basic properties of our sun and the sun spectral irradiance falling on Earth. Then we will split the global irradiance into several components. Finally, we will introduce the concept of equivalent sun hour for a certain location on Earth. The core of our star, the Sun, is so dense that the radiation cannot travel freely. Electromagnetic radiation is continually absorbed and re-emitted until it comes to the surface, that is called the photosphere. Here, part of the energy is released as spectral irradiance, forming the Sun spectrum. The temperature of the solar surface is about 6000 Kelvin, and it behaves as a black body at the same temperature. In this diagram, you can see the spectral irradiance of our spectral power density of a black body as a function of the wavelength. This is the most common way of characterizing a light source expressed in watt per square meter at a particular wavelength. This electromagnetic wave travels from the Sun through the outer space until our planet. Due to Earth's atmosphere, this nicely shaped black body radiation translates into something wavy and noisy. Just outside the atmosphere of the Earth, the spectrum keeps its regular shape, and this is what we call the air mass zero, or AM0, depicted in red, because no atmosphere is traversed. Then, as the sunlight travels through the atmosphere, the spectrum of the global irradiance received on a flat horizontal surface shows several dips in the absorption that are related to scattering and absorption by air molecules and dust particles. For example, the dips related to the absorption of light in molecular oxygen, molecules of water, and the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere are here indicated. All these molecules contribute to the absorption of solar radiation at wavelengths above 1,000 nanometers. Instead, the green curve is the direct AM1.5 spectrum. It is obtained from the global AM1.5 spectrum by considering only the light shining in the direction normal to the illumination plane. The shape of the spectrum is very similar to the blue curve, but its intensity is sensibly lower in the visible part of the spectrum. Now, I want to remind you the meaning of the air mass, which is a measure of the length of the light path through the atmosphere. The reference to calculate the air mass is when the Sun is at its zenith. And here, as we have already seen, we can identify two spectra. Firstly, the AM0, obtained outside the atmosphere, and then the AM1, obtained on the Earth's surface. However, not always the Sun is perpendicular to the location, and thus light has to travel through the atmosphere for a longer path. So, the air mass is given by the ratio of the actual path length of sunlight through the atmosphere, L, divided by its minimal distance, which is obtained when Sun is perpendicular to the location, L0. The air mass can also be expressed as 1 over the cosine of angle theta between the Sun and the zenith. Here, the AM1.5 is depicted, also called the standard reference spectrum, since it is used to characterize cells at lab and the industrial level. It is obtained when the Sun has an angle of about 48 degrees with the zenith. When the spectrum is integrated over a certain wavelength range, then we obtain the irradiance, which is the power density of light per unit surface. In this context, G is the typical letter to indicate the irradiance, and you can come across several subscripts with a different meaning. But as long as you see G, it means that you have a unit which is watt per square meter. This equation illustrates the integral of the AM1.5 global spectral irradiance. When we consider the entire wavelength interval that goes from 250 nanometers to the infrared, around 3000 nanometers, then the outcome of this integral is 1000 watt per square meter. Such a number is used to evaluate the performance of solar cells and modules in laboratories and industry. Now, we are going to see how to measure the irradiance. We need an hardware called the pyranometer and another type of hardware called the pyrheliometer. Basically, they are electronic devices, not more different than a photodiode, that count how many photons their surfaces receive. Then, these devices change this information into a voltage signal that can be read by a software. Here we define the global irradiance as the sum of the diffuse component and the direct component. Many times in literature, you can find also these acronyms. So, GHI stands for Global Horizontal Irradiance, DHI for diffuse horizontal irradiance, and the DNI for direct normal irradiance. Let's have a look in detail at these different components and how to measure them with a setup such as the one depicted on the left. The GHI is measured with the pyranometer over here, and it is called the global horizontal irradiance because the pyranometer has a very large eyesight, so it can get the horizon and the whole hemisphere on top of it. Of course, this should be set as much as possible parallel to the ground where you will actually install the PV system. The pyranometer in the red box number 2 measures instead the diffuse horizontal irradiance. It has the same configuration as the previous one, but a shading disk obstructs the direct irradiance. An embodiment of the shading structure is the black ball here on top. Finally, the DNI is measured with the pyrheliometer highlighted in the red box number 3. It is mounted on a two-axis mechanical stage that follows the Sun at any moment of the day, and it always points towards its direct component. The direct normal irradiance is thus obtained by shielding the pyranometer in a black tube. In order to obtain the direct component on a horizontal surface, we have to multiply the direct normal irradiance by the cosine of theta z, which is the angle between the zenith and the sun position. One last definition to conclude this lecture. The equivalent sun hours, ESH, also called the peak sun hour. An equivalent sun hour, specifically, is an hour during which the intensity of sunlight is 1000 watt per square meter. The ESH is used to measure how much solar energy is available in an area during a typical day. In the graph, we see the radiance, or solar radiation, during one day. The area under the curve, in yellow, corresponds to the solar insolation, which is given in energy per unit area. In order to obtain the peak sun hour, the solar insolation has to be divided by the irradiance of AM1.5, which is 1000 watt per square meter, and the result is the number of hours. The corresponding graph of the irradiance has this rectangular shape that covers the same area of the other one. In this last slide, the insolation in terms of annual average ESH is shown. Five regions can be distinguished and are highlighted with different colors. In the Netherlands, the annual average equivalent sun hours per day is 2.7. So, depending on the position on the Earth and the position of the sun in the sky, terrestrial solar radiation varies both in intensity and the spectral distribution. To conclude, today we have seen the sun spectrum at different air masses after having resumed the concept of air mass. Then we divided the global irradiance into two components, the direct and diffuse, and we saw how to measure them by means of pyranometers.